Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cognitive Gadgets, The Cultural Evolution of Thinking by Cecilia Hayes. Narrated by Esther Wane. Introduction. What makes us such peculiar animals? Compared with other creatures, we humans lead very strange lives. No other animals have so completely transformed their environment, become so dependent on cooperation for survival, and constructed, along the way, the vast edifices of knowledge and skill in which all human lives are embedded. Technology, agriculture, science, religion, law, politics, trade, history, art, literature, music, and sports. Why? What is it about the human mind that enables us to live such unusual lives? And why do our minds work that way? In this book, I argue that the answer to these questions is cognitive gadgets. We humans have created not just physical machines, such as pulleys, traps, carts, and internal combustion engines, but also mental machines, mechanisms of thought, embodied in our nervous systems, that enable our minds to go further, faster, and in different directions than the minds of any other animals. These distinctively human cognitive mechanisms include causal understanding, episodic memory, imitation, mind reading, normative thinking, and many more. They are gadgets rather than instincts, because, like many physical devices, they are products of cultural rather than genetic evolution. New cognitive mechanisms, different ways of thinking, have emerged not by genetic mutation, but by innovations in cognitive development. These novelties have been passed on to subsequent generations, not via genes, but through social learning. People with a new cognitive mechanism pass it on to others through social interaction. And some of the new ways of thinking have spread through human populations, while others have died out, because the holders had more students, not just more babies. Psychologists often use gadgets as metaphors. They suggest that various aspects of the human mind operate in the same way as circuit boards, cisterns, searchlights, search engines, thermostats, resistors, and the bristles of a Swiss Army knife. But if I am right, the resemblance runs much deeper. Distinctively human ways of thinking are products of the same process, cultural evolution, as machines in the outside world. They are pieces of technology embodied in the brain. Genetic evolution has given humans more powerful general-purpose mechanisms of learning and memory, tweaked our temperaments, and biased our attention so that it is focused on other people from birth. But, drawing on comparative and developmental psychology, cognitive neuroscience, philosophy, anthropology, behavioral economics, and theoretical biology, I argue in this book that it is the information we get from others, handled by general-purpose mechanisms, that builds distinctively human ways of thinking. The first three chapters lay some foundations for cultural evolutionary psychology. Chapter 1 says more about the cognitive gadgets theory, what it is and what it is not, explaining how and why cultural evolutionary psychology builds on evolutionary psychology and cultural evolutionary theory. Chapter 2 draws on the philosophy of biology, arguing that, although we now know that some versions of the nature-nurture debate were deeply misguided, it is important to discover, for any particular feature of human cognition, the ways and extent to which the feature is shaped by 1. Genetically inherited information, 2. Culturally inherited information, and 3. Information derived directly from the environment in the course of development. Chapter 2 also includes an overview of contemporary cultural evolutionary theory, showing how it can be applied, not only to cognitive products, grist, but also to cognitive mechanisms, mills. Chapter 3 focuses on features of distinctively human cognition that have been shaped primarily by genetically inherited information. It surveys behavioral and neurological evidence that, far from being blank slates, or just like the minds of chimpanzees, The minds of newborn human babies are equipped with high-capacity mechanisms of learning and memory, species-specific attentional mechanisms, and a tendency to find social cues especially rewarding. Chapter 4 examines the nature of cultural learning that enables cultural inheritance, the cultural analogue of DNA replication, and provides an introduction to the heart of the book, chapters 5 to 8. Each of these chapters examines a type of cultural learning: selective social learning, imitation, mind reading, and language, and argues from the available evidence that its distinctively human characteristics depend on culturally inherited information. I focus on the mechanisms of cultural learning, the cognitive gadgets that enable humans to learn from others with extraordinary efficiency, fidelity, and precision, for two reasons. First, these distinctively human cognitive mechanisms are especially important because they are gifts that go on giving, culturally inherited skills that enable a cultural inheritance of more skills. Second, evolutionary psychologists and cultural evolutionists disagree about the origins of many cognitive characteristics, but both parties are convinced that the mechanisms of cultural learning are cognitive instincts, not cognitive gadgets. This consensus suggests that the mechanisms of cultural learning are the hardest nuts to crack, the cognitive mechanisms that are least likely to be explicable as products of cultural evolution. Social learning is said to be selective, or to involve social learning strategies, when the impact on behavior of observing another agent varies with the circumstances in which the encounter occurs, or with the characteristics of the observed agent, or model. For example, when older models have more impact than younger models. In Chapter 5, I argue that most selective social learning, found in non-human animals, children, and adults, is due to domain-general learning and attentional processes. That is, to processes that have not been specialized for social interaction, let alone for cultural inheritance. However, a small proportion of social learning strategies, found only in adult humans, depend on explicit metacognition, on thinking about thinking. These, and only these, behavior effects are genuinely strategic and genuinely examples of cultural learning. The evidence suggests that, like other explicitly metacognitive rules, these metacognitive social learning strategies are learned through social interaction, culturally, rather than genetically inherited. Imitation occurs when an observer copies the topography of a model's action. Observing the way that parts of a model's body move relative to one another causes the observer to produce movements in which the parts of his or her own body move in a similar way. In Chapter 6, I agree with the century-old view that imitation is special, much more highly developed in humans than in any other species, and dependent on mechanisms that are not involved in other kinds of learning. I also agree that these mechanisms contribute to the fidelity of cultural inheritance. My rebellious streak comes out only in relation to the question of where imitation comes from. Offering an original theory of the mechanisms mediating imitation and a wide range of empirical evidence in support of that theory, I argue that the capacity to imitate is acquired through socio-cultural experience. Mind reading involves the ascription of mental states, such as beliefs and desires, thoughts and feelings, to oneself and to others. In Chapter 7, I suggest that genuine mind reading contributes to cultural inheritance primarily by enhancing the effectiveness of teaching, but that many of the behavioral effects attributed to mind reading, the implicit or automatic effects reported in apes, infants, and adults under time pressure, are not genuine cases of mind reading. They are due to domain-general psychological processes. These processes can generate predictions about behavior that simulate the effects of mind reading, and when they do, the agent may be described as submentalizing. Where does real mind reading come from? From the same kinds of conversation-based social interactions that support the development of print reading or literacy. It is culturally inherited. No one doubts that language, communication using words or signs in a structured and conventional way, is a hugely important form of cultural learning. When it comes to language, the crucial question is not whether it is a form of cultural learning, but where the language faculty originated, genetic or cultural evolution. In Chapter 8, I approach this debate as an outsider, neither a linguist nor a language scientist, and with an open mind. Indeed, it would have been convenient for the purposes of this book if I had found in the language debate a compelling case for an innate language faculty, a rock-solid cognitive instinct on which cultural evolution had constructed cognitive gadgets. But that is not what I found. Insofar as the two ideas can be tested against one another, I find the case for the cultural evolution of language at least as strong as the genetic alternative. The core chapters, chapters 5 to 8, have particular selling points. Chapter 5 addresses very directly a question which cultural evolutionists have tended to avoid. Exactly what is it about selective social learning that promotes cultural evolution? Chapter 6, on imitation, looks in detail at how a new cognitive mechanism can be constructed by domain-general cognitive processes through social interaction. Chapter 7 presents an innovative view of mind reading, offering an alternative to the long-established nativist and theory-theory perspectives. Chapter 8 gives an informed but dispassionate overview of the current status of the debate about the origins of language. I have read widely, but I don't have a dog in that fight. All of the case studies are unusual in bringing to the cultural evolutionary table theory and evidence, not only from primatology and developmental psychology, but from experimental psychology and cognitive neuroscience. The final chapter takes a step back to consider how the cognitive gadgets theory measures up against the chronology of human evolution and what it implies about human nature. Cultural evolutionary psychology implies that human minds are more agile, but also more fragile than was previously thought. We are not stuck in the Pleistocene past with Stone Age minds, and well-targeted educational interventions have the potential to transform cognitive development. But we have more to lose. Wars and epidemics can wipe out not just know-how, but the means to acquire that know-how. The cultural evolutionary perspective also has disciplinary implications. It does not suggest, as have many evolutionary psychologists, that all research on human minds and human lives must be informed by evolutionary theory. On the contrary, it suggests that research on the developmental and evolutionary origins of human cognition should be informed by the humanities and social sciences. Chapter 1: A Question and Many Answers. In this chapter, I first outline how the cognitive gadgets theory differs from other, recent answers to the question, what makes us peculiar? I locate my answer within the logical geography of contemporary research on human evolution. Then I explain how and why the cognitive gadgets theory builds on some of the other answers, and suggests that the origins of literacy provide a proof of principle for cognitive gadgets. Logical geography. Dimensions. Some political and religious groups hold that the differences between humans and other animals are due to supernatural forces and provide moral justification for privileging human interests over all others. In contrast, contemporary scientific inquiry assumes that any differences between humans and other animals, in degree or in kind, result exclusively from natural processes, many of them evolutionary, and while the differences may inform debate about the ethical treatment of animals, their moral implications are far from self-evident. When scientists ask, what makes us peculiar, they are not assuming that humans are the only peculiar animals, or that our peculiarities make us morally superior. By definition, all scientific inquiry about human distinctiveness aims ultimately to explain the manifest differences between our lives and the lives of other animals, the differences in geographical distribution, habitats, and habits that the proverbial Martian would be able to detect while visiting Earth. Scientists look for explanations in a variety of places. Some research focuses on our bodies, for example, tracing the effects of bipedalism and our remarkable manual dexterity. Other work zeroes in on the brain, emphasizing that our brains are unusually large relative to our bodies, and that certain parts have expanded more than others in the course of human evolution. A third focus is on behavior, the things people do. Perhaps a key to understanding human distinctiveness lies in our social behavior, use of tools, or control of fire. The final major focus of evolutionary scientific inquiry about human distinctiveness is on the mind. Research of this kind tries to identify the mental processes or ways of thinking that make humans special. Of course, these four foci, bodies, brains, behavior, and the mind, are complementary, not competitive. The mind is implemented in the brain is part of the body, the mind-brain controls behavior, and behavior is enacted by the body. Ultimately, therefore, a full explanation of the peculiarities of human lives must integrate research with all four foci. Evolutionary answers to the question, what makes us peculiar, also vary in the extent of their preoccupation with history and forces. Answers that are high on the historical dimension, narrative theories, offer a sequence and chronology of key events in human evolution. For example, they link major changes in brain structure and behavior with climactic or demographic events that may have provoked those changes. Answers that are high on the forces dimension, force theories, are concerned with the processes involved in human evolution, cultural inheritance, epigenetic inheritance, gene-culture coevolution, genetic assimilation, genetic drift, and niche construction, as well as natural selection operating on genetic variants. All of these processes will be discussed later. The ideal theory would be synthetically high on both historical and force dimensions. It would use chronology as evidence of forces, and forces to explain chronology. There are already some admirably synthetic theories, but synthesis is a very tall order. The patchiness of the fossil and archaeological records compels narrative theories to be speculative. They are often dismissed as just-so stories. And when detailed narrative is combined with analysis of forces, the resulting story can be intractably complex and untestable. Evolutionary psychology. Where does the cognitive gadgets answer lie in this map, defined by foci and preoccupations? How does it compare with the neighbors? The focus of the cognitive gadgets answer is firmly on the mind. In agreement with what is known as evolutionary psychology, or to distinguish it from other evolutionary approaches to the study of mind and behavior, as high church evolutionary psychology, I am convinced that relationships between the brain, behavior, and the world cannot be understood satisfactorily without a middleman. That is to say, without describing those relationships at an abstract mental level. Imagine someone hunting in the wilderness with a spear. It may be possible, with the help of immensely complex mathematical models, to document what typically happens in the hunter's brain whenever there is a change in the pattern of light entering his eyes as he scans the horizon. It may even be possible to correlate those light-related changes in neural firing with the hunter's behavior. Type A patterns predict he will continue scanning. Type B patterns predict he will crouch closer to the ground. And type C patterns indicate he will raise his spear. But this huge, complicated matrix of inputs, brain activities, and outputs would not make sense of the hunter's action, or provide information about what he is likely to do under different circumstances, unless it were translated into mental terms. For example, into a description of what the hunter sees, misses, wants, and knows. Terms like seeing and knowing refer to the kinds of activities and relations documented in the hunter's correlation matrix. They do not refer to extra things done by the brain or by a spooky mental substance. However, without abstraction of the kind that mental terms provide, behavioral science and neuroscience provide information without insight and precision without predictive power. In common with many evolutionary psychologists, I believe some of the most effective abstractions come not from folk psychology, seeing and knowing, but from cognitive science. Folk psychology refers to the blend of wisdom and old wives' tales that we use to talk about the mind in everyday life. It explains behavior with reference to the thoughts and feelings, beliefs and desires, of whole agents. For example, Nabila nodded her head because she wanted to bid for the Miro and believed the auctioneer would understand her head movement to be a bid. The term cognitive science has been used since the early 1970s to refer to interdisciplinary scientific research on the mind. The disciplinary mix includes experimental psychology, computer science, linguistics, neuroscience, and the philosophy of mind. Many of the explanations offered by cognitive science liken the mind to a computer, cast thinking as information processing, and are pitched at a subpersonal level. That is, in contrast with folk psychology, which takes mental states of the whole person, for example, beliefs and desires, to be the drivers of behavior, cognitive science often explains behavior as deriving from the activities of parts of the mind and of the interactions among these parts. For example, Nabila said blue when she saw blue written in green ink because two parts of her mind, one responsible for naming colors and the other for reading words, competed for control of Nabila's speech mechanisms, and the reading part won the contest. The subpersonal explanations offered by cognitive science are not familiar or intuitive, but they burrow deeper into the mind than folk psychology, and many have survived rigorous experimental tests. Introducing cognitive science to inquiry about human evolution, and vice versa, was one of the primary purposes of evolutionary psychology, and it is likely to be its most enduring achievement. The forerunner of evolutionary psychology, human sociobiology, attempted to explain the evolution of distinctively human social behavior, especially altruistic behavior, either without mentioning minds at all, or while relying on casually generated folk psychological characterizations of how the mind works. Similarly, the still thriving field of human behavioral ecology largely ignores the mind as it uses mathematical modeling to investigate whether distinctively human behaviors, especially foraging behaviors, are likely to be adaptive, to enhance reproductive fitness, and if so, to be adaptations, to have evolved because they enhance reproductive fitness. Adopting a strategy that has been described as the phenotypic gambit and black boxing, human behavioral ecologists sometimes allude to the brain, but very rarely to the mind. And when they do say something about the mind, they usually reach for folk psychology. Consequently, although sociobiology and human behavioral ecology have provided valuable information about human evolution, I think evolutionary psychologists were right to point out, some 20 years ago, that it was high time the mind was taken more seriously. The cognitive gadget's answer is at one with evolutionary psychology in focusing on the mind and emphasizing the importance of cognitive science in explaining human distinctiveness. However, the cognitive gadget's answer is completely at odds with evolutionary psychology, or at least with the part known as high church evolutionary psychology, in its claims about the forces that have shaped, and continue to shape, the human mind. Most evolutionary psychologists argue, assert, or merely assume that genetic evolution is the architect of the human mind. According to this cognitive instincts view, distinctively human ways of thinking are in our genes. A newborn human baby does not enter the world understanding causality with a full supply of mental maps and talking complete sentences, but she contains in her genes very specific programs for the development of these capacities, programs that are capable of building distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, such as causal understanding, mental mapping, and language, with minimal help from learning. The environment in which a child grows up is seen as triggering or evoking cognitive development, not, as it is in the cognitive gadgets theory, as forging or constructing distinctively human ways of thinking. Cultural evolutionary theory. Cognitive gadgets is a force theory rather than a narrative theory. It is consistent with what is known about the chronology of human evolution, refer to chapter 9, but it is primarily concerned with the processes that have shaped the human mind and regards learning, especially social learning, and cultural evolution as dominant among these processes. In emphasizing the importance of social learning and culture in explaining why humans live such peculiar lives, the cognitive gadgets theory is akin to cultural evolutionary theory. Contemporary cultural evolutionary theory emerged in the 1980s, building on ideas formulated in the preceding 20 years and resolutely rejecting the politically stained social Darwinism of the Victorian era. It is now a broad church. Refer to chapter 2. Cultural evolutionists are united in believing that evolution, defined as a change in the distribution of characteristics within a population over time, can be powered not only by genetic inheritance, but by cultural inheritance. Characteristics, or traits, can increase or decrease in frequency, not only as they become more or less likely to be passed on to biological descendants via genetic mechanisms, but also as they become more or less likely to be passed on to cultural descendants, who may or may not be genetically related to their cultural parents through social interaction. The crucial difference between contemporary cultural evolutionary theory and the cognitive gadgets theory concerns the traits they have in their sights. Until now, cultural evolutionary theory has been applied to observable behavior and artifacts. For example, it has been used to explain change over time in the frequency of people in a population who have a small family, or who use a particular kind of fishhook. In contrast, the cognitive gadgets theory applies cultural evolutionary theory to the mechanisms of thought, the mental processes that generate and control behavior. For example, it seeks to explain change over time in the frequency of people in a population who are capable of calculating a shortcut across unexplored territory, mental mapping, who can entertain a theory about how an instrument works, causal understanding, or who have cognitive equipment allowing them to copy facial expressions, imitation. The cognitive gadgets answer is concerned not with the grist of the mind, what we do and make, but with its mills, the way the mind works. When questions arise about the origins of distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, even the most enthusiastic and pioneering cultural evolutionists begin to look remarkably like high church evolutionary psychologists. They may deny with great resolution, and on the basis of sophisticated mathematical models, that genetic mechanisms are responsible for the evolution of human behavior, grist, while assuming without comment, or on the basis of meager evidence, that distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, mills, have been fashioned by the genes. This juxtaposition is particularly striking when it comes to the cognitive mechanisms that enable cultural inheritance, mechanisms known collectively as social learning or cultural learning, refer to chapter 4. The picture painted by contemporary cultural evolutionary theory has the virtue of simplicity. Genetic evolution has given humans mechanisms for cultural learning, and using these cognitive instincts, we learn from others most of what we need for survival and reproduction in the particular geographical area and particular social group in which we live. It is a simple picture, but I argue that it does not line up with the evidence from cognitive science. That evidence suggests that the distinctively human cognitive mechanisms involved in social learning are not only processes, but also products of cultural evolution. In summary, the cognitive gadget's answer to the question, "What makes us peculiar?" is like evolutionary psychology in targeting the mind and drawing on cognitive science, and like cultural evolutionary theory in emphasizing the importance of social learning as a force in human evolution. However, It is quite different from both of these approaches in suggesting that distinctively human cognitive mechanisms are gadgets rather than instincts, products of cultural rather than genetic evolution. Given these similarities and differences, the cognitive gadgets theory represents a progression from evolutionary psychology and cultural evolutionary theory that I call cultural evolutionary psychology. Fellow travellers, although the cognitive gadgets theory is at odds with evolutionary psychology and cultural evolutionary theory on the origins of distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, I most certainly am not a lone voice in the wilderness crying, "Culture changes the way we think." For many social anthropologists, especially those who identify themselves as cultural psychologists, this is a fundamental tenet of their work. They regard all aspects of the mind as interdependent with the cultural environment in which it develops, to the point where mind and environment are inseparable. This conviction, among researchers who have a rich body of direct experience with people from non-Western cultures, provides encouragement for the cognitive gadgets hypothesis. However, cultural evolutionary psychology departs from cultural psychology and from the approach adopted by most social anthropologists in being rooted in cognitive science and evolutionary theory. For example, it takes a keen interest in characteristics that are typical of humans, as well as variation between individuals and groups. Also, cultural evolutionary psychology does not seek to abolish the distinction between nature and nurture, refer to Chapter 2, or to revise our everyday ontology in which minds continuously interact with, but are distinguishable from, the world around them. Other voices saying, "Culture changes the way we think," come from cross-cultural psychology. In this field, where many researchers draw on cognitive science, experiments in which people from different cultures are given the same behavioral tasks reveal both species-typical human psychological characteristics and fascinating patterns of between-group variation. Cross-cultural psychology is, arguably, a methodology rather than a research program with its own theoretical framework. Consequently, there is significant potential for synergy between cultural evolutionary psychology and cross-cultural psychology, with the former providing theory and the latter evidence. Within the logical geography of research on human distinctiveness, the theories that lie closest to the cognitive gadgets theory are those of Barrett, 2017, Dennett, 1991, Carmiloff-Smith, 1995 and 2015, and Tomasello, 2009 and 2014. Barrett's theory of constructed emotion has a different focus, emotion rather than cognition, and does not invoke cultural evolution specifically, but, like cognitive gadgets, it is rooted in cognitive science and underlines the importance of social interaction in shaping human minds. Dennett's multiple drafts account of consciousness implies, but does not state explicitly, that cultural evolution can shape cognitive mechanisms as well as cognitive products. Carmiloff-Smith's theory of representational redescription makes no reference to cultural evolution, but is a pioneering attempt to specify, within a cognitive science framework, how socio-cultural experience could produce new cognitive mechanisms. Finally, like the cognitive gadgets theory, Tomasello's shared intentionality hypothesis is a direct answer to the question, "What makes us so peculiar?" focusing on the psychological processes involved in cultural inheritance and emphasizing the importance in cognitive development of learning through social interaction. However, the shared intentionality hypothesis seeks a single psychological source of human distinctiveness, shared intentionality, rather than a set of distinctively human cognitive processes, mental mapping, causal understanding, imitation, etc. It is theoretically and empirically rooted in a Vygotskian psychology, rather than cognitive science, and it appears to assume that humans genetically inherit highly specific propensities for cultural learning. If this is correct, unlike cultural evolutionary psychology, The shared intentionality hypothesis implies that what we think depends on cultural learning, but the way we think depends on our genes. Why now? At the heart of the cognitive gadgets theory of cultural evolutionary psychology is the idea that social interaction in infancy and childhood produces new cognitive mechanisms. It changes the way we think. Until recently, this idea would have been very difficult to evaluate, since there was minimal contact between research on social interaction and cognitive mechanisms. Social psychologists examined how groups and individuals interact, but took little interest in cognitive mechanisms. On the other hand, cognitive psychologists were keenly interested in cognitive mechanisms, but applied their theories to asocial problems. For example, how a person who is, or might as well be, alone in a room sees an object, remembers the past, types on a keyboard, or finds the door. Since the 1990s, this situation has changed rapidly and radically. The field of social cognitive neuroscience, which combines social psychology, cognitive psychology, and developmental psychology with lashings of brain imaging, is now one of the most vibrant and richly funded research enterprises in the natural sciences. Social cognitive neuroscience makes it possible, for the first time, to take a really close look at the mechanisms responsible for online control of social interaction, and crucially, at the role of social interaction in their development. For example, social cognitive neuroscientists have shown, using a combination of mathematical modeling and brain imaging, that many of the mechanisms involved in human social learning and teaching have deep evolutionary roots. At the core of human social learning and teaching are the same basic mechanisms used by all vertebrates and many invertebrates to learn about predictive relationships between events. The same associative or statistical mechanisms that enable bees to learn that flowers of particular colours yield more nectar, and birds to learn that if their beak strikes a mollusk at a certain angle with a certain force, the shell will open. This implies that, in many cases, distinctively human ways of thinking are not as brand new and shiny as we thought. They are made of old parts and, therefore, tweaking by genetic evolution, rather than heavy lifting, would be enough to get their development going. Refer to Chapter 3. Reading, or literacy, was studied by cognitive psychologists long before the eruption of social cognitive neuroscience. But brain imaging has confirmed dramatically that training a person to read reconfigures his or her cognitive system. This transformation is a proof of principle for cultural evolutionary psychology. It demonstrates that new cognitive mechanisms, and specifically, new mechanisms of cultural learning, can be produced by cultural evolution. First, reading is an immensely powerful and distinctively human form of cultural learning, a cognitive process that enables those who are literate to access a huge store of information acquired by previous generations. Second, it is clear that reading has been made possible by cultural evolution. Written language emerged only 5,000 to 6,000 years ago, too recently in human history for the genetic evolution of cognitive mechanisms dedicated to reading. Research on the cognitive mechanisms involved in reading is informed by experiments measuring the speed of processing and the kinds of errors made during reading by healthy literate people, and by people with various types of brain damage. According to one of the most prominent theories, the dual-root cascaded model, the data from these studies imply that each competent reader has distinct cognitive routes from seeing a letter string to reading it aloud. Each of these routes, and some of their component processes, is constructed by the process of learning to read. Even when a component is in place prior to literacy training, root construction transforms the way it operates. Illustrating the scale of the changes induced by literacy training, brain imaging has shown that viewing written sentences activates large areas of the cortex more strongly in literate than in illiterate adults. These areas include the right occipital cortex, which is involved in relatively low-level visual processing, and a focal area of the occipitotemporal cortex. The latter area is known as the visual word form area, VWFA, because it responds so reliably, in literate people, to the presentation of written words. If one did not know that reading is culturally inherited, it would be easy to mistake the reliable responding and precise localization of the VWFA for signs that the capacity to read depends on a cognitive instinct or an innate module. So, learning to read has major constructive effects on the neurocognitive system. It does not, of course, create a new system from scratch. Like other genetic and cultural processes of adaptation, learning to read takes old parts and remodels them into a new system. The old parts are computational processes and cortical regions originally adapted, genetically and culturally, for object recognition and spoken language. But it is a developmental, cultural process, literacy training, that makes them into a new system specialized for cultural learning. The case of reading shows clearly that distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, including mechanisms of cultural learning, can be culturally inherited. Cultural evolutionary psychology asks, how far does this go? To what extent are other distinctively human cognitive processes constructed and inherited through social interaction? Conclusion. The cognitive gadgets theory, or cultural evolutionary psychology, addresses the question, what makes human lives so peculiar? It is a force theory rather than a narrative theory of human evolution, akin to evolutionary psychology in focusing on the mind, and to cultural evolutionary theory in emphasizing the importance of social learning and culture in shaping human characteristics. However, cultural evolutionary psychology makes a radical departure from both evolutionary psychology and cultural evolutionary theory in proposing that distinctively human cognitive mechanisms, ways of thinking, have been built by cultural evolution. They are cognitive gadgets rather than cognitive instincts, pieces of mental technology that are not merely tuned, but assembled in the course of childhood through social interaction. Some of the components and engines of construction are genetically inherited, but the designer of the human mind is natural selection acting on cultural, rather than genetic, variants. We are taught the thinking skills that make us peculiar. Those skills are not in our genes. The recent emergence of social cognitive neuroscience makes cultural evolutionary psychology a timely development in research on human evolution, and research on the acquisition of literacy provides a proof of principle. To take culture seriously, we need to rethink the distinction between nature and nurture. Laying some groundwork for cultural evolutionary psychology, Chapter 2 tackles the nature-nurture issue and takes a closer look at what is meant by cultural evolution. Chapter 2. Nature, Nurture, Culture. The development of every aspect of human behavior and cognition depends on a rich, turbulent stew of factors. Even the development of something as simple as fight-or-flight reactions to threatening stimuli depends on complex looping interactions between a multitude of DNA sequences, genes, epigenetic markers, environmental inputs, such as threat stimuli, parental care, nutrition, and the current state of the neuroendocrine system that these resources have conspired to produce. The rich interactive complexity of developmental processes makes it absolutely clear that, in cognition as in other biological systems, there are no pure cases of nature or of nurture. No biological characteristic is caused only by the genes or only by the environment. The absence of pure cases has led some people to conclude that the nature-nurture debate should be abandoned, but this simply does not follow. The composition of a cake never depends solely on the ingredients, nor solely on oven settings, but it still makes sense to ask to what extent, and in what ways, The various ingredients and oven settings contribute to the cake's appearance, flavour, and texture. Similarly, although every biological characteristic is the product of nature and nurture, it remains coherent and important to ask, for any particular characteristic, to what extent and in what ways nature and nurture contribute to its development. Indeed, answering these questions is, arguably, one of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.